Hello, hello, everybody. It's 3 p.m. UK time, which means it's time for another episode of Children's Talks in Astronomy During Lockdown. Today, we have me, Joanna, talking about what's killing the galaxies, the cosmic Cluedo, as I refer to it. So, this talk is an interactive one, so please make sure in order to join the fun, ask questions, and take part in quizzes, please make sure to join at slido.com using the event code Cluedo. You might as well also scan the event QR code, which is displayed in the slide right now. At this point, I would also like to welcome you back to the Cambridge Institute of Astronomy YouTube channel. If you like this series of talks, please smash like and subscribe for more, as we are holding children's talks every Tuesday during lockdown. We will also feature an astronomy book club and astronomy related arts and crafts, so there's a lot to look forward to, so please subscribe and keep up to date. Without further ado, let's go. So before we begin, let me first remind us about two important things that we need to keep in mind throughout this talk. First of all, what is a galaxy? It might sound trivial, but for those of you who are new, let me brush up a little bit. So, galaxy is a collection of stars and gas that are held together by a common gravitational potential. What you see in the image here is our own galaxy, the one that the solar system resides in, the Milky Way, as seen from the Earth. This particular picture was taken in New Mexico, United States, with a beautiful sky and very little light pollution. So it's unlikely you would see that kind of sky in the United Kingdom, but maybe if you live a bit further out, you might be able to see the Milky Way on a clear night. Now, this is not the only Milky Way, our own galaxy, is not the only galaxy in the universe, and the image we're more used to is this one, the Whirlpool Galaxy. And as I've said before, this is a collection of gas and stars. You can see the stars by the yellow light. You can see some dust lanes. If I also turn the pointer on, there we go. So you've got the stellar light, you've got the dust lanes, you've got gas, and each and every spot in this image is a birthplace of new stars, which I will come to in a moment. So that's what a galaxy is. Let's remember that as we go along. The next thing to remember is that light has a finite speed, which means when we look through a telescope, we not only look at a distance in space, but we also look back in time. So please keep in mind that every galaxy I am going to show you is not its current state, but rather a historical picture of what the galaxy used to be like, mostly a couple good millions of years ago. Actually, majority of the objects I'll be showing you today will have emitted their light around the time that dinosaurs stepped on Earth. So let's keep that in mind as we go on. Now, I would like to introduce you to the topic of galactic death, the way my supervisor does it, so I stole his idea. But before I do that, let me show you the first quiz to warm us up a little bit. So you are probably familiar with this image if you've seen previous talks given by Matt before. And I would like to ask you if you know which telescope is responsible for taking that image. I see the numbers of responses rising, so I'll give you guys a couple of seconds to make your choices. There are many to choose from. So let's see how you guys do. And in the meantime, I'll do some question moderation to make sure I answer all of your questions at the end of the talk. All right. I can see there's almost 300 responses in. So how about we reveal the results and go on? So majority of you said that it is Hubble Space Telescope, and indeed majority of you were right. I don't know if you remembered it from the previous talks. If you did, please let us know in the comments below. It's really interesting to see you engage. So please let us know what you were thinking. What is important to realize about this image is that it shows the darkest patch of sky we could find from the Earth's perspective. And it would be impossible to take this wonderful high resolution picture from Earth just because we've got all the atmosphere in the way, making it difficult. So once we've established that this is Hubble Ultra Deep Field, if we take a look at this image and mask objects that are obviously stars, marked with white crosses here, and close our eyes a little bit and ask ourselves, what can we see in the image? First of all, we realize there are a couple of things that look blue, the ones I've marked with circles, and a couple of things that look red. Again, marked with red circles this time. There are also a couple of things that are in between, and I will choose to mark them as green for historical reasons. Now, the question we would like to ask ourselves is, where does the color of a galaxy come from? This is an important piece of information for us to learn how galaxies die. So we need to start with the building blocks of galaxies. These are stars, and the ones that have just been born, the ones that are young, are also hot, and they're blue in color, like the ones I'm showing you in the slide right now. There are all the stars that have already evolved and live for quite some time are no longer this hot, they're cooler, and hence redder. So if you make up a galaxy, the universe is not as simple as we would like it to be. So blue galaxies are not only composed of young stars, and red galaxies are not only composed of the red stars, but what counts in determining the overall color of a galaxy is the relative proportion of these two stellar species. So a blue galaxy will seem blue as long as there is enough young stars being born to overshadow the red stars that have lingered for a while. For red galaxies, it's the exact opposite. So we'll have more old stars with very residual amounts of star formation and new stars being born. What it looks like in reality? Well, there you have it. A blue galaxy on the left and a red galaxy on the right. What you will also notice is that the main difference doesn't only lie in color. They also have different structure. So the blue galaxy that is actively forming stars will have well-pronounced spiral arms. You will see the dust lanes that we've noticed before. You will see these very high brightness regions where new stars are being born. For a red galaxy, it's rather sad and boring. What is even more depressing is that majority of local universe actually does look like that. So there are no more spiral arms, no more dust lanes. It's all just a smooth blob of light. It is pretty in itself, of course, but when we think of a galaxy, the first image that springs to mind is obviously the one on the left. So I've said multiple times, and the title already hinted at galactic death, but what does it really mean for a galaxy to die? This was touched upon Matt last Tuesday, so let me quickly remind ourselves of that. So the first thing we might think of is, if a galaxy dies, does it mean that a galaxy like this, actually it's two galaxies, the antennae galaxies, merging together, so that would be one of them, that's the second one, and they're caught in this beautiful spiral dance as they come closer and fly through each other. So the question you might ask, if a galaxy dies, does it mean that it completely disappears? Well, the answer is no. What actually happens is the galaxy on the left, I mentioned that a couple of times already, has a lot of gas that is available for forming new stars that are responsible for the blue color. Now, during the evolution of the galaxy, once something, and we'll get to what that is, once something happens to this creature over here, the galaxy will stop forming new stars. It will no longer have the source of blue light. It will no longer it will no longer shine in this bright blue hue. So what will happen is all those stars that have been formed before, they are not going to vanish. They will still keep on living because they do have long lifespans. And the galaxy will slowly transition to become the galaxy on the right, devoid of gas, devoid of dust, devoid of spiral arms, pure stellar light. So based on what I've just said, galaxies that are actively forming stars are considered alive in the astronomical jargon. And the galaxies that are no longer forming stars and they're just lingering around with all the stellar light that they've produced before are called dead. And the transition between blue star forming to red and dead in galactic jargon is called galactic death. Of course, I'm simplifying the words right now, and it might sound funny, but in reality, that's how we refer to those objects when we talk about them in conferences or in meetings. So another question one might ask is that true that blue galaxies transition to become red, and what evidence do we have for it? Well, one of ways to think about that is taking a look back in time through the cosmic epochs. So we are here right now, and that's actually Hubble Space Telescope. And as we look further and further in space, as I mentioned before, we're looking further and further in time. So what you can do is at every distance in the universe, you can take a measurement of how many red and blue galaxies there are for a given distance, and then track the evolution of this population as a function of time. And what astronomers have found through this exercise is that at the early times in the universe, it was mostly blue galaxies with a little bit of red. So early in the history of the universe, the galaxies were mostly star forming. They were actively buzzing with new stars being born, full of blue bright light. And as we move closer towards modern epoch, and when I say modern, let's remember my remark about the dinosaurs. modern day universe emitted its light sometime around Tyrannosaurus Rex stepping on Earth. So when we look at the modern day, the situation is different. We find more red galaxies than the blue ones. And hence, the interpretation is that the blue and red galaxies form an evolutionary sequence in which the blue ones transition to become red. Now that we know that galaxies, blue galaxies transition to become red and the process is called galactic death, the question is, what is killing the galaxies? And that's where the title comes in, because answering this question is a little bit like playing a Cluedo game. And my question to you right now is, do we know what kills the galaxies? It's not a quiz, it's a poll, so I would like to know, what do you guys think? Do you think astronomers know well what's happening to the galaxies, or are we still a little bit concerned we might not be knowing everything yet? I'll give you a couple of seconds to respond, and in the meantime, let me moderate the questions. All right. Oh, wow. 400 people responded. Well, I'm really curious to see your opinion. So let's see. Oh, no. Wait. Can I? Oh, no. I think I've successfully reset the response. I'm really sorry about that. No. So, I'm really sorry for my technical difficulties, but I've seen that 36% of you answered yes, and the vast majority, 64%, answered no. And you are correct. Well done. We really don't know. We're really not sure what is killing the galaxies. So the real answer to the question is, we don't know for sure. And that's where Cluedo comes in, because astronomical research in this area is a little bit like playing a Cluedo game. In this scenario, however, we're not investigating the murder mystery in a haunted house. Instead, we're investigating the murder mystery of galaxies. And the evil force that's playing against us is the universe, tossing cards with clues in front of us. And what I mean by cards with clues are the observations that we can make, because we do have rather limited choice regarding what exactly we can observe. And at this point, let me highlight that astronomy is strikingly different from other forms of science that can be performed in a laboratory. Take, for example, a chemist who is interested in seeing what the reaction between A and B will be if we put them together. They can easily do that, measuring the appropriate proportions, putting them together, and seeing the result. In the process, before and after, they can measure the chemical composition, pressure, temperature. They can record the sound, record the smell of the substance. Take all of those measurements, and on top of everything, they can observe this reaction in real time. For us astronomers, it's not as fortunate. When we want to learn something about the universe, not only can we not recreate astronomical events in a lab, but also almost all of the information that we have about the universe comes in the form of light. Finally, most relevant processes that we're interested in take millions of years to happen. So, unlike a chemist who can take a picture of before and after in a time span of a couple of seconds, we can only see still snapshots of the universe and have to connect the dots in between using our theoretical reasoning in order to understand what's going on. And at this point, I've made it way too interactive. So at this point, I have a quick question to you. It might be a bit tricky, but if you've listened to previous talks, you might have the answer ready. I would like to ask you guys, what signal can astronomers use to observe the universe? Is it like in the case of a chemist, smell, sound, light, gravitational waves, maybe, or something as exotic as cosmic rays, or all of the above? Again, I'll quickly look at the questions you're asking me. They're flooding in and they're absolutely amazing. So please, please do not be sad in case I do not get to your question. It's just there are so many of them and all of them are brilliant. So it would probably take forever to get through all of them. Whoa, answers are flooding in at a record speed. One is tempted to say the speed of light, huh? So let me wait until it's 400 because it's a nice round number. And as astronomers, we really like round numbers. We actually work in orders of magnitude. So the difference between 350 and 400 is non-existent in the language of an astronomer. Yay, 400. Let's see the results. So, majority of you said that we can see light, but also the next most popular answer is gravitational waves, and there we're on cosmic rays. A good fraction of you, a bit more than one-fifth, said that it's all of the above. So let me reveal the correct answers. And these are light, gravitational waves, and cosmic rays. The reason why we cannot smell the universe or we cannot hear sound waves through the universe, it's because the space between astronomical objects is mostly vacuum. So if you think of the signal that is coming your way from the sun, from the Earth, and this is a very small distance in the astronomical realm, the only information we have is the light from the sun. We cannot smell the sun or hear any sound waves coming from it, just because whatever is separating us and the sun is nothing but vacuum. So a good approximation. So what does the universe tell us through information that we've just discussed, cosmic rays, light, and gravitational waves, about how galaxies die? Where? Well, just like in the game of Cluedo, it passes a couple of cards our way. First of them is a mass card. And what I mean by this is that in the observable universe, across different epochs, we see that galaxies are more likely to be dead if they are massive. When they're light, they're more likely to be forming stars. Another card tossed our way is the environment card, which means that astronomers observe that the higher the density of galaxies, the more likely they are to be dead. In low density environments, it's the exact opposite. The final card tossed our way is the black hole card. Galaxies with more massive black holes are generally observed to be dead. And the ones with smaller black holes are still actively forming stars. So to understand which processes can be responsible for shutting down star formation, let us quickly recap how stars are born. So what happens is we have a cloud of gas in a galaxy, which fragments into smaller chunks. Each of those chunks will then collapse under its own gravity until it becomes so dense that it ignites and the blue hot stars are born. So that seems easy enough, right? There are two main ways in which you can prevent that process. Either no gas, no stars, simple, or a bit more complicated, a lot of gas, but somehow still no stars. And at this point, let me tell you that this is an area of active research. We really have more question marks than answers in this part of our knowledge of the universe. So, unfortunately, I won't tell you anything about it today because the community does not really know much. But chances are that some of you listening right now, watching and listening right now, might in the future become astronomers and actually answer these questions. So please do get interested. We need those ideas. But with no gas, no stars, the case seems to be much simpler because the universe does provide a lot of observational evidence for what kind of processes might be at play. Let me start with these wonderful structures. These are supernova remnants photographed by, again, Hubble Space Telescope with the participation of other telescopes as well. Supernovae are violent explosions of stars, which differ in properties depending on what kind of star explodes. But one thing that unites all of them is that they're extremely powerful and they are able to sweep the surrounding gas and eject it further away. So if you imagine a galaxy that's like a disk, a supernova that blows up will poke holes in it, making it look like Swiss cheese. So supernovae are capable of removing galactic gas, of course, depending on a particular galaxy, but they are one potential culprit to blame. Another way you can remove the gas is by being in a very dense environment. What I'm showing you here in the slide is, obviously, this is not a galaxy, but this is a jellyfish, and the reason why it's here is because those two galaxies that I'm showing you in the slide are officially called jellyfish galaxies. Yes, that's a proper scientific term. And the reason for this term being here is if you take a close look at the galaxy, say this one, you will see the galactic disk, the spiral arms, but there is something dragging behind, if you take a close look, these blue strands of gas left behind. The reason why that happens is because this galaxy is moving through a dense environment through a lot of hot intergalactic gas called the intergalactic medium. And as it does in the process, it's experiencing something called the ramp pressure, which strips the gas that's unable to hold on to the galactic gravitational potential. You can imagine recreating this process, maybe to better visualize it for yourself, if you go to the seaside or a lake, grab a handful of sand and try to drag it underwater with your palm not entirely closed. You will see that the grains of sand escape your hand, forming a pattern very similar to the jellyfish tentacles. So just like that, just by streaming through a ball of hot gas, the gas is not visible in this image, that's important to realize, because it's too hot to emit light in the visible spectrum. So the space looks transparent to us, but if we were to take the image in a different wavelength, in X-rays, it would reveal a lot of gas hiding underneath. So gas can be stripped from galaxies when they stream through the intergalactic medium. So that's already a second weapon of choice in our Cluedo game. Finally, and ultimately, admittedly, my favorite weapon of choice is the activity of the central supermassive black hole. You may be familiar with those images because these jets, of very hot matter moving at high velocities make for wonderful, wonderful images. But what happens is at the center of each galaxy, we believe that each galaxy hosts a supermassive black hole at its center. You may have heard about black holes earlier in Matt's talk as well. And what would happen with the supermassive black hole, why it is called supermassive, it's because it weighs millions and billions of times more than our own sun. Now, this amount of mass generates a lot of gravitational potential, which then allows for a very hot accretion disk to create around the black hole. The matter is very, very strongly attracted by the black hole and then launched into these powerful jets that reach out all the way out of the galaxy. What you can see, for example, in this image showing the Hercules galaxy, the galaxy light ends here, while the jet extends 1, 2, 3, almost 4 times the size of the galaxy out of Hercules. And we are talking about thousands or more millions of light years across in this image. So these are extremely powerful events. And what can happen is that the supermassive black hole launching this jet can drag a lot of gas out of the galaxy at very high velocities, allowing it to escape forever and never come back. This image might be less familiar, but I wanted to acquaint you with it. It's because this is a jet of the M87 galaxy, the very same galaxy that we used to take a first picture of the black hole shadow. So now that you see how bright it is, you can then imagine how difficult it was to get close to the black hole and take the picture of its immediate surroundings and not be dwarfed by all the overwhelming light coming both from the jet and the galaxy itself. And we do seem to have a fairly good theoretical understanding of how the feedback, as we call it in jargon, of supermassive black holes works. What I'm showing you here is a video from the illustrious collaboration who simulated the universe in a box using best prescriptions they could to understand how the gas and stars and dark matter interact. And what you're seeing here right now is just a distribution of dark matter, but very soon it will switch to show you the temperature of gas. There we go, we've got the change of color, and yes, now we have the temperature of gas. And what you can see is that the centers where there's most matter located, you will see a little bit of flickering. This is the action of the supermassive black hole just heating the gas up in its immediate proximity, but these giant explosions are what we understand as the gas from the galaxy being pushed away by the action of the supermassive black hole. So all of those clues that I've just described to you are also find reflection in our theoretical understanding of the universe. So we are pretty sure that we are onto something with that weapon of choice. The question now is, who is it to blame? And unfortunately, as much as I would like to give you a single response, the answer is, well, it depends. It depends on what kind of galaxy we're talking about. How massive is the galaxy? Is it separated from other galaxies, or does it live in a closely knit environment of a galactic cluster? Even more so, all the observations I've just described to you are based on predominantly optical light. Now, the real interesting player in this game would be the actual gas that can form stars. But that is very, very hard to achieve, and it will take it will take a big technological leap for us in order to do statistically meaningful studies to understand how galaxies die. So the mystery has not been solved yet. And please do not lose hope, because I am sure that maybe one of you can crack it in the future. As a final quiz, since you've been so good at participating in those quizzes, I would like to ask you one final question. It might be tricky, so don't worry. But I'm really keen to know what you think. Which of the processes that I've described before can be important for the death of the most massive galaxies in the universe? Can it be supernova explosions? Remember, stars exploding, sweeping up gas and ejecting it from a galaxy. Ram pressure stripping. That's a jargon way for saying the jellyfish scenario. Or is it the supermassive black hole activity? Or maybe all of the above? What do you think scientists right now debate or agree on regarding the death of the most massive galaxies that we see in the observable universe? Answers are flooding in. Fantastic. Wow, you guys are really quick. In the meantime, I'll quickly take a look at the questions. Oh, wow, 370 responses already. Fantastic. You guys are doing great. If we can rock it up to 400, which gives me extra time to accept your questions. I'm really curious to see what your responses are. Also, when I look through the questions, I've seen some of you asking, why is my question always waiting for review? So the way it works is that when you submit a question, I have to manually approve it in order to make sure that no unpleasant words pop up in our conversation. And since there are so many of you who are very active, and we very much appreciate it, it also means that my thumb has to be very, very quick. And hence, you might be waiting for a long while. I'm really sorry. I apologize about that. Okay, we're nearly at 400, so let me reveal the response real quick, and we'll soon go into the Q&A session. So let us take a look at the results. And wow, most of you responded that it's all of the above combined. Then the second Then the second most popular question was supermassive black hole activity. Then we've got supernova explosions and ram pressure stripping. Let me reveal the correct answer. From what astronomers think might be the case. And let me quickly address why it is supermassive black hole activity. So as much as all of the above might have acted on the galaxy throughout its lifetime, the one that seems to have had the most important impact seems to be the supermassive black hole activity. And the way we probe that, and that's something I actually do for my research on a daily basis, is we take a look at which of those parameters, the supernova explosions, the ram pressure stripping, or the black hole activity, which of them seems to be most tightly bound in a mathematical fashion to the question of whether or not a galaxy is dead. And it seems like it is a supermassive black holes for the win for the most massive galaxies. But if you didn't get this answer right, don't be sad, because that's a question that is currently debated by everyone in the galaxy death community. So if you if you've given any other answer, you would be with you would have a lot of good company out there agreeing with you. Whoop, sorry. Yay. So before we go into the questions, I would like to give you three takeaway points to remember from this brief talk. First of all, galaxies in the universe can be broadly split into two groups: the blue, star-forming, or alive, and the red, passive, dead. When we say that a galaxy is dead, we do not mean that it disappeared entirely. What we mean, rather, is that it's not forming any new stars, so it will still shine, it will keep on lingering around for a long while, it's just that it will no longer form new stars. And the question of what is killing the galaxies still remains very much open. Our current research is making very good progress at identifying potential, let's call them, weapons of choice involved, such as the supermassive black hole activity streaming through the hot intergalactic gas, or supernova explosions. So with this, I hope you've learned something today. And on that note, let me move on to the questions. Okay. So here they are. The first top question is from Zach and Sam, both age 9. Welcome. What galaxy has the best chance of life? And it's not the Milky Way. That's a very good question, Zach and Sam. We currently it is very difficult to look at distant solar systems, planetary systems, just like ours, but further away. And the best knowledge we have right now is about the ones that are in our own Milky Way. So there is very little we can speculate about different galaxies. In principle, you might as well just look at the sky and point in a random direction and say, yes, this galaxy has a very good chance of hosting life. So to an extent, you can probably predict which galaxy is more likely. For example, the one that will have older, more evolved stars, which have already produced heavier elements that are crucial for the carbon-based life that we know of to come to be, then those more evolved galaxies are maybe more likely. But the real answer to your question is, we have no idea. Because it's far beyond the certain reach of our instrumentation right now. But thank you very much for the question. It's very interesting. Now, the next question is, what happens if you go through a black hole? And it comes from Jaden W. Hi, Jaden. It's it's a fun question, I agree. And it's rather theoretical because no one has ever been to the black hole and back, not to mention going through the event horizon, because at this point it's game over. One of the things that you may have heard of is spaghettification. So due to very rapid changes in the gravitational field as you come close to the black hole, your feet will be pulled a bit more than your head. So imagine if you stand on the ground, the reason why you're standing on the ground is because Earth's gravity is pulling you. Now switch the Earth into a black hole. Not a safe choice, by the way, but let's do a theoretical experiment. And and the pull that was uniform on Earth, so your head was weighs, well, your head feels similar to your feet, will no longer be the case to a black hole. And your feet would get pulled further and further away from your head. And what you will end up as is a giant spaghetti. That's why it's called spaghettification. I'm pretty sure it's very unpleasant. So let's not get close to black holes in the near future in case we decide to build a spaceship capable of that. But thank you for your question. I really enjoyed it. Oh, what would happen to Earth if the Milky Way died? Asks Noah. Good news is, probably nothing much. Because, as I've mentioned before, the death of a galaxy does not mean the galaxy stops existing. What death of a galaxy means is that the galaxy will no longer be forming new stars. So actually, if anything, the death of Milky Way might be only good for the prospects of Earth surviving. Because if the galaxy is actively forming new stars, it also means it will be actively producing more stars that can go supernova. And if you remember the images I've shown you, the gas that can be blown out to very large distances, if a galaxy is actively forming stars and has stars going supernova, the chances of such a blast coming our way are non-zero. And if a galaxy is completely dead and only has old stars lingering, then the chances of such an explosion are significantly lower. So nothing bad would happen to Earth in such a scenario. Of course, it depends on how Milky Way would die exactly, but assuming it would die peacefully, we wouldn't be threatened at all. Thank you for your question, Noah. Now we've got a question from Henry B. Do different things kill different size galaxies? I think I've managed to answer that, but let me quickly recap. Yes, that is true. If you have a smaller galaxy with a smaller gravitational potential, then supernovae might have a very strong effect on the given galaxy, just because the energy associated with a supernova explosion is roughly constant. So if you imagine a small galaxy that can only weakly hold on to its gas, if it has a couple of stars going supernova, they can poke it like Swiss cheese and get rid of all of its gas. But if you have a very massive galaxy which holds on to its gas very, very well through strong gravitational potential, then all the explosions can do is simply blip and bubble the gas instead of ejecting it. So yes, Henry, the answer to your question is yes, different things kill different size galaxies. And the same thing goes with streaming through hot intergalactic gas. The smaller the galaxy, the more difficult it is for this galaxy to hold on to its gas. So the smaller it is, the more jellyfish it will become. Thank you very much. Let's move on. We've got a question from Tristan, who is 7 years old. If I read that correctly, if new stars can't form in a galaxy, is it dead? What if something changes so that stars can be formed in it again? When do we consider a galaxy to be dead? That is a fantastic question. It is a conference level question that you can easily hear in conferences being organized all across the world on this topic right now. So the galaxy is considered dead based on its the measurement of how quickly it is forming stars, which we call the star formation rate. So we only have access to a given snapshot of a galaxy. So a galaxy is considered dead based on the snapshot we observe it at, a picture. But there, it might be the case that a dead galaxy meets with a galaxy that is full of gas and has potential for forming a lot of new stars. And when they meet and they collide, the gas is compressed, new stars form, and suddenly the galaxy is rejuvenated and it's no longer dead. So yes, it is possible for a galaxy to come back from the dead, if you will. But we do not call those galaxies zombie galaxies. We're not as cool as that. But in principle, it is possible. So the classification of whether or not a galaxy is dead is based on how much stars it is forming for its mass. I hope I answered your question correctly, Tristan. By the way, fantastic question. Well done. So that's the speed at which a galaxy spins impact its likelihood of dying. That's a question from Tristan as well. That's a very interesting question. And again, well, first of all of your questions are interesting, so I'll probably should stop saying that. But I hope that you mean that by the galaxy spin, you mean the speed with which it's the galaxy is rotating. So it does. I am not aware of research that would say that there is a direct connection between the speed of spin and likelihood of dying, but for sure there is a connection between whether or not a galaxy is dead and how quickly it spins. So those galaxies that are dead are mostly spherical, and they would be rotating at smaller velocities. And those galaxies that are alive are mostly disk-like, and they would be rotating at high velocities. So it's less to do with the likelihood, but maybe more with the characterization of whether or not a galaxy is dead. Oh wow, there are so many questions from you guys, and I am far behind on moderating them. I am terribly sorry. Yes, unfortunately, I underestimated how many questions can be asked. Okay, let's get back. So does the speed at which... Okay, yeah, we've already answered that. So what is the biggest dead galaxy that has been found so far? Wow, Zach. That's a specific question, and I believe, to the best of my knowledge, it is IC1101, the one that Matt showed you in the previous presentation. If you remember, the size comparison of this gigantic blob of stars, that's exactly the galaxy I'm talking about. So I believe this is the biggest one found so far. So Mohamed Ali asks, what are the chances of the Milky Way dying or being killed, and what is the most likely cause of it if it were to happen? That's a fantastic question I haven't pondered too much. So first of all, let's remember... Oh, wow. Okay. You guys keep on voting, so the questions skip. So... So first of all, Milky Way does not live by itself. It has a sister galaxy, Andromeda, and they are going to collide sometime in the future. When exactly? It's a very good question. Unfortunately, I do not have an estimate off the top of my head. but they are going to collide for sure. So during this collision, what can happen is Andromeda and Milky Way can stream a lot of gas to the region neighboring the supermassive black hole at the center of the Milky Way, activating it, which can lead to potentially launching those powerful jets that I've showed you before. These will likely have a very strong impact on the star formation within the Milky Way, probably potentially shutting it down. So I do not have a definite answer, but the chances of Milky Way dying within our lifetime are none. And in the future, it has for sure an interesting history to look forward to. However, we cannot predict the future for now with certainty. Thank you for your question. Brad, what will happen if two galaxies collided? Oh, great. I partially responded before. So when two galaxies collide, remember, although galaxies look like dense objects in the images I've shown you before, they're mostly empty space. So what happens is they swoosh through each other. So stars do not collide. And if they do, it is a very rare occurrence. But what happens is gas, that the very thin gas that stays between the stars, it gets clumped together and compressed, hence inducing more star formation. And if it happens, and if the gas happens to be drawn very close to the black hole such that it creates an accretion disk and in consequence a jet, then the result of such merger would be launching of a powerful jet. Thank you very much for your question, Brad. Okay. Ozak and Sam, what is the most beautiful galaxy in the universe? Oh, that's a wonderful question. And the answer is to each their own. So each and every one of us will have their own most beautiful galaxy in the universe. But I can tell you about two galaxies that are often quoted as being extremely beautiful. One of them I've shown you, actually I think I've shown you both of them. One of them is the Antennae galaxies. So it's two galaxies, so it's cheating, it's not one of them. And what I find beautiful about them is that the shape they make in this beautiful cosmic dance is absolutely incredible. So if you want to look them up and take a closer look, either you can look at them at the video once the live stream is complete, or you can easily look them up on the internet. So that's Antennae galaxies. The other galaxy, always quoted as a model spiral galaxy, is the Whirlpool galaxy, featuring beautiful spiral arms, lovely dust lane structure, a lot of sites of new star formation. So if I were to take a guess who is running in the beauty pageant for galaxies, then that would be Whirlpool and Antennae. Thank you very much for your question. Callum. Okay, when did we figure out what was killing galaxies? When did we start figuring out what was killing galaxies? Well, I guess it's a fairly new field, so probably first strong claims could have been made 20 years ago. So not that far. Well, it might sound like a lifetime, more like a lifetime to you. But it is definitely a very young field in terms of astronomy. I'm terribly sorry for stuttering. However, I'm trying to accept more of your questions because there are a lot of them and I am not quick enough at accepting this. That's where machines are superior to humans. We should code up a bot to sift through the questions so that you guys do not have to wait for my approval. Yeah, let's do that. Okay. So the next question. What does a one-year-old galaxy or younger look like? Interesting. First of all, let me say that the youngest, well, it's impossible for us to tell with certainty if something is less than, I guess, 10 million years old, because that's roughly how certain we are, for example, at looking at distant galaxies, at galaxies, and looking at the new stars that are born in them. So our accuracy with determining how old these stars are is roughly 10 million years. So we're not doing a very good job. So it's impossible for us to determine whether something is 1 year or younger. That's for starters. Second of all, the process of... It's difficult to say when a galaxy starts. Does it start with the first collection of stars that come to be? Or does it become a galaxy when it already evolves a structure? These are difficult questions to answer. And if you're interested, Jaden, and if you follow through with astronomy, I'm looking forward to hearing from you in a couple of years' time, maybe answering those questions. All right. We've got another question from Jaden. I'll answer it real quick. What happens if you put something bigger than a black hole through a black hole? Well, black hole will tear it apart first and then consume it in a form of hot plasma, just like it happens with stars. So technically, nothing bigger than a black... If you're worried that a black hole is like a keyhole that you cannot fit through, don't worry. The universe finds its ways to make things smaller and eat them up. Now we've got a question from Joshua 11. Could it be that a ridiculously massive black hole is sucking in all the galaxies? Well, it could have been the case if the universe was different. But no, it's impossible, just because the universe is expanding. So no matter how much gravitational attraction a particular ridiculously large supermassive black hole will have, the galaxies will still keep on going away from one another. So there is, if you're worried that there is one ridiculous supermassive black hole that is sucking all the universe in, including galaxies, stars, gas, and rock stars, don't worry about that. The universe is already... has already fixed that with its own expansion. Now we've got a question from John. Is there a way we can farm galaxies for resources? Wow, that's very... I wasn't expecting that question. So I'm sorry to say, John, but before we come up with a method of travel that is faster than the speed of light, which is currently impossible due to general relativity, then I'm afraid not. Just because the distances between galaxies are so large. It takes 8 minutes for light to travel from sun to the Earth. And it takes light, if I remember correctly, roughly 50 million years to travel from M87 to us. And this is a fairly nearby galaxy. So no, I believe we cannot farm them for resources. As of yet. But thank you for your question. Amara asks, how do black holes kill their own galaxies? Well, I hope I explained that before. So a quick recap. What they can do is they can launch powerful jets that would drag a lot of gas out of the galaxy and hence get rid of the fuel for future star formation and, in effect, kill a given galaxy. William, how long is it until the Milky Way and the Andromeda galaxies collide? Well, unfortunately, I responded to that question saying that I have no certain answer. I'm sorry. But it is way beyond human lifetime, so you have nothing to worry about. But if you're interested in seeing Andromeda coming closer to us, then I have to disappoint you. It will not happen. Now we've got a question from Anonymous. How do galaxies make stars? Well, I hope I answered that with the slide with clouds. So galaxies per se are not, they're not sentient beings. So they do not decide, oh, I'm going to make some stars now. It all has to do with the local density of gas. So if in a given galaxy, there is a concentration of gas that is dense enough for it to collapse, form a dense ball, and then ignite under its own pressure caused by gravity, then that's when a galaxy forms stars. So the key ingredient is the gas. If the galaxy doesn't have a gas, there is no force that can create a star out of nothing. Oh, we've got a question from Sebastian, age 7. Why are elliptical galaxies sleeping? They are sleeping, i.e. not being active, because they do not form new stars. And the reason why they don't is because elliptical galaxies are in general devoid of gas. Or let me be more precise. They do have gas, but this gas is much hotter than the cold gas that is required for stars to form. So the hot gas will have a lot of pressure, which will prevent it from collapsing into forming new stars. And those elliptical galaxies can have tons of it. Actually, they do shine in X-ray, like M87. I keep on referring to it because it's a very famous example. But M87, if you look at it in X-ray, it reveals a whole sea, not a sea, an ocean, a galactic ocean of very hot gas that is unable to cool and form new stars. So elliptical galaxies are sleeping because they do not have enough cold gas to form new stars. Thank you very much, Sebastian. Caleb, oh, when is it estimated that the Milky Way will die? I think there is no estimate. That's probably the most honest answer I can give you. Potato Team, I love the name. When will the Milky Way galaxy die? So that's the same question as previously. The answer is we don't know. What will happen in the future to the giant galaxies? Asks Luca, age 7. So if they're already dead and they reside at the centers of galaxy clusters, then they most likely will stay dead or sleeping, if you will, for the rest of the lifetime of the universe. But if a giant galaxy happens to still have some star formation and it's on a collision course with another galaxy, then it might as well still go through periods of very violent star formation called starbursts. If you remember Matt's talk last week, episodes of the starburst activity can also occur. So there is no certain answer about the future, and there is no certain answer about the past in astronomy, in fact. There is only statistically probable answers that we can give to all those questions. So at this point, I've realized it's already 4 p.m. UK time. I'm really sorry. I'm in a different time zone, so I had to think twice. On that note, I would like to thank you very much for joining in for today's talk. I hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. Please remember to hit the like button if you liked the talk. Leave a comment below if there is something you would like to know and didn't manage to ask this question during the session, or simply if you have some feedback for us. And finally, if you're new, please subscribe for all the wonderful content that the Institute of Astronomy is going to put out in the coming weeks. So stay tuned and happy skies.